are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello again, and welcome to The Individual in Society. My name is Sergio Soto, and this is your weekly sociology course. For those of you who are taking the course, one of the things I want to let you all know is that we have some more assignments posted. Your first writing assignment prompt is available. When we get to gender socialization, I'll talk about the prompt a little bit, and we also have an exam. Do read the instructions first. The exam is designed in a way that allows you to not only take it multiple times, but that your best score will be used, right? So have all your material in front of you. My expectation is that you use the resources that you have available when you're taking the exam. If you have your book in front of you or your notes, anything like that, I don't consider it cheating. You know, there's no way of policing it if you do or don't anyway. But have your textbook, have your notes, have your slides, all of that. Read the instructions. You can take it multiple times, but understand that you won't get the same exam again. More than likely, the same folks won't get the same exam. Even if you have classmates, it pulls from a random block of questions. But anyway, the deadlines are there. If you have any special problems or questions, write me during the week, please, and let me know if I can accommodate you in some way. Let's go over some questions before we get into our new topic, where we really go into socialization, the construction of identity, and some of the theories surrounding it, in particular, Mead and Piaget. So during the week, I prefer the emails, so I have some emails that we'll just run into real quick. Alexander wrote in with this very good question: when we call some countries a developing country, third world country, do they generally agree with our view or disagree? In our text, it describes China and India as developing nations, yet in my experience, every Chinese and Indian disagrees. And they certainly disagree with the idea of being a less developed society or a less industrial nation. After all, everything in stores seems to be from either China or India. Or it also seems to have a condescending tone to call a country a third world nation. So very good question. We'll go over it when we talk about our first section in global poverty. If you want to read ahead, there's that section in chapter 20, which we don't really get to cover in this course because of time, which is globalization. I do recommend that chapter if you're really interested in it. But to answer your question, I think there's three parts to the question. Maybe your last point, I'll cover it. This is something that in regards to the condescending tone that people from nations outside of what is considered developed or what people label as third world would agree. Even people in the in our country, in our society, would agree because when we think about industrializing or development, it's always seen as better, but one of the things that we can be critical about is whether it really is better. For example, sure, people might have McDonald's restaurants, Xboxes, and all kinds of technology if they're developed, but does that mean that people who don't have that are less than or suffering? No. Sometimes, you know, arguably their quality of life is better in some terms. Like, for example, when people travel around the world, you know, maybe even to like a country like Bhutan, where the level, you know, it's supposed to be one of the happiest nations or something like that, if I'm remembering correctly. But anyway, around the world, people, you know, will see Americans or, you know, for example, you know, live the life of leisure when they travel. You know, they might go to India or China, you know, eat at nice restaurants, stay in hotels, you know, swim in the pool, shop. But what they often don't see is that, you know, sometimes for families or individuals, for the most part, to pay for these trips, they had to save and work extra hours and overtime for, you know, a few years even. So, I mean, that's one part that kind of distorts it. You know, on the other side, you know, in these less developed countries, maybe people don't, you know, have more time. You know, they certainly enjoy doing things with friends and family, you know, so, I mean, that you really don't need to have any, you know, economic influence. So that is in, you know, in the discourse. Now, to cover the other parts, when we talk about first world, third world, generally, I know in our society, and when people use that term, it gets thrown around a lot, but it's a little antiquated. And you did touch on that. Basically, when it first was used, first world described the, you know, and this was a term that emerged during the, you know, after, during the Cold War, after World War II. First world was, were the countries that were industrialized and adopted the liberal democracy, which is what we have, you know, capitalism and state, you know, states ran by the citizens, you know, republics. Second world referred to the Soviet bloc, so, you know, you might wonder why it jumps from first to third world, well, when people use it today. And the answer to that is that the Soviet bloc, you know, is gone. So the second world arguably doesn't exist anymore. And the third world was basically all the other countries who had not developed to the same level. Now, what we do prefer to use when we look at the status of economies and the livelihoods of people around the world is the term development. So there's developed, developing, and least developed. Okay, so, and again, arguably, you know, you kind of only have three categories, and it doesn't do a good job at explaining like the complexities of economic, global economic life, or, you know, different societies. You know, you can kind of think about our own class system, which we'll talk about very soon. You know, having upper class, middle class, and lower class really doesn't describe the, you know, the level people can live at. Someone can be upper class and have billions, or you know, just maybe $200,000 or $300,000. That's a big difference in terms of, you know, how they live. Or when we look at poverty, you know, someone could be right at the poverty line, and then we have folks who have, you know, absolutely nothing. You know, they might live unhoused and whatnot. Anyway, going back to this point, in general, when we talk about development, it's the overall economy. And it is true that you point out that there is a level of prestige associated with it, and some of what goes on can be distorted by what we see. For example, when we you know, go to the store, a lot of things might be made in China or other developing countries, or countries that are categorized as developing. You know, just to give you an example, you know, Mexico is developing still, right? You know, there's some discussions about Korea. I think Korea is developed, but, you know, Mexico, some people argue, is developed. But basically how it breaks down is the complexity of the economy. If you think about our economy, people do farm, but it's on the industrial level. You know, for the most part, it's done by machines and it's automated. When you think about technological advancements, and a good way to think about how the economy is really pushed forward and how technology propels the economy is to think about how and when new innovations come up, right? Even though China makes a lot of things, you know, everything that they basically make is considered old technology, like computers, televisions, even solar panels. Solar panels have been around since the 70s. Now, China's trying to change this. That's why they, you know, are adopting or making their adopting, American universities over there, in the sense that, universities like Duke and other prestigious universities are opening up campuses in mainland China. They're investing a lot in research. They're getting to the point where they're inventing new technology. And that's where, you know, when we talk about how economies make money, you know, if it's high technology, they make more money. You don't want to, if you're in an economy, you don't want to get stuck making the technology of 10, 20, or 30 years ago, right? There's not as much money in it, for instance. So when we look at developed, you know, we're not only looking at the economy, but the infrastructure. You know, if we use China as an example, they have huge cities, you know, some that whose architecture and infrastructure rival some of the best cities in the United States. However, when you look at the country as a whole, right, you know, a lot of the population doesn't live in the same kind of cities. You know, you go here in a small suburb, you know, or even, you know, like you could think about our farming districts, like the Central Valley, right, in California. It's you know, the roads are more or less, you know, the major highways are good. You know, the cities that are there are, you know, have good infrastructure. You know, that I don't think you'd find the same level of in those terms development all over China. You know, arguably China's bigger, but they are making strides to catch up. So you do touch on some good points, but in terms of when people use developing, developed, and least developed are those, you know, those countries that are, prone to famine, extremely poor. And when it, you know, these terms, when they get used in society, we really don't talk about how they really work, and they often get misused. So I think that's where the stigma kind of emerges from. Like, people will say, oh, that's, you know, that's something you'd only find in a third world country. You know, like if you see someone starving. But I mean, you have starvation here, you know, it's just less likely people die from starvation, but we do sure have malnourishment. The big point is that yes, we do use these terms, and for the most part, we don't generally use them to stigmatize when we use them in a professional manner. It's just to describe how their economy looks, their infrastructure. If we're looking at a state, the services the state provides its people, and the general overall economic health of the individuals. You know, when we won't get into this discussion, like if we just look at, somebody might be familiar with GDP, right? This used to be the benchmark to kind of illustrate whether a country was healthy or not, like how high their GDP was. But this is no longer the case, because GDP distorts, you know, the truth. Like, for example, in China, you know, when we look at GDP and compare it to the average income, there's a huge disparity, right? And you can think about average income as a good way of, you know, figuring out how developed the society is, right? You know, even though people in our country are poor, you know, they might, you know, our poverty level for like an individual is about $12,000 a year. You know, $12,000 in another country, you know, that's maybe even middle class, right? So anyway, very good question. We'll definitely speak more to this, Alexandra, as we move forward. If you want to read ahead, there's definitely, very good chapters on this topic, especially chapter 20. Brandon writes in, how has culture progressed in America from the 50s to the millennium era, or, today. You can look at all institutions, religion, education, the economy, the family, etc. Everything, you know, everything changes, right? And just to kind of think about it too, you know, if you look at the 50s and look 50 years backwards to like the 1900s, you also see all these institutions changed before they got to the 50s. So society's always in flux. Things are always changing. Just really quickly, I mean, you can look at the family. Before, the dominant family form was to live with extended family. Then in the 50s, it was the nuclear family model that was seen as normal. And then today, you know, all that's been challenged. You have, cohabitation, single parents, same-sex parents, parents who both work. You know, one of the things about the nuclear model is that it was a breadwinner homemaker model, right? So usually the men worked and, you know, they brought in the income, and usually women inside that family, the adult woman, the mother, or wife would stay home and take care of the, you know, social reproduction, the domestic labor. So that's not the case today, you know, and we'll speak to that when we get to gender roles. So, your question will constantly be answered throughout the course, Brandon. But very good question, and I appreciate that you're, inspiring conversation here. Maybe last one, Pilar writes in, if physician-assisted suicide were made nationally legal, would we as individuals be considered immoral, unethical to take someone's life? And as a society, would we be positively or negatively affected by this? So when we think about like physician assisted suicide, there's already an ethical debate. Some people argue that, again, as you might be aware, that any suicide is immoral, but others feel that in certain circumstances, to prevent human suffering, it's immoral to allow a person to suffer. So, you know, that's kind of the discourse. Now, if it's legalized, right, if anything, it kind of will be a kind of temperature check of our ethics in our society. Now, from my personal standpoint, I'll move away from my own personal standpoint, but I'll throw this idea at you. You know, one of the things about taking life, you know, it's always one of these questions about morality, but when we think about it in the larger social structure, it is a very good exercise to think about what culture really says, right? You know, for instance, one thing that's going to be on the ballot in California, from my understanding, is that the citizens of California are going to vote on whether capital punishment or the death penalty will continue to be a tool in our legal structure, you know. And there people argue that, you know, taking the life or having the state take a life, even though a person may have done some horrible things, is unethical, right? So it's really, you know, what it might suggest about our future society. I mean, there's always going to be positives and negatives, you know, and it's all about social, you know, like the position that you're in, all about how maybe even you've been socialized to understand these topics. You know, if someone's very religious, for example, and even depending on their type of religion, like for example, if they're Catholic, you know, it's highly immoral. You know, other religions, you know, it might not be as ethically concerning, right? Or maybe even the situation, you know, it all depends. Like, surely in our society, I don't think suicide would be normalized like you see in like a cartoon like Futurama, right, where they have like suicide booths. But I do think that, you know, it would broaden the discussion, you know. There's a lot we can speak to it. I mean, euthanasia is something that, you know, has been practiced before. I mean, we practice it in, you know, not on humans, you know, for the most part, but, you know, we practice it on animals, right? You know, So anyway, it's ethics, yeah. So ethics change, and whether it's positive or negative is always about perspective, right? You know, who's to say what's going to happen in 100 years, you know? Anyhow, very good question. So I don't think I really answered your question, Pilar, but it's a difficult question to kind of speculate on. So it's really one of those discussions about where a person is inside our culture and the circumstances of, what is seen as moral or immoral. And that's basically what we as a society are sorting out. But if it's legalized, you know, the pro side of, those who support physician-assisted suicide, would have made large strides, and it would probably influence culture to view physician-assisted suicide as a positive thing. But it could also have an unexpected reaction. You know, one of the interesting things, I don't know if we talked about this before, like when we look at the debates around abortion in the 70s, one of the things that people speculated in the 70s is that the abortion debate would subside as, you know, time went on. But what we find is that, you know, the debate around abortion has intensified, right? With both sides becoming more, more entrenched in their ideology or their perspective or the way they frame the issue. So, this could happen too. You know, if euthanasia is or physician-assisted suicide is legalized, you know, you could see an intensification of the debate. Like right now, a lot of people might not have an opinion, but, you know, moving forward, they might have it. It might be one of these contentious issues, just like abortion is. So anyway, that's it for questions today, I guess. I spent more time, very good questions though, on interesting topics. So let's talk about socialization. Socialization in the life cycle, you know, one of the big things we have to understand is that socialization is a social process. It's the process through which children develop an awareness of social norms and values and achieve a distinct sense of self, right? The important, to underline all this, it never stops. Even though we mentioned children in the definition, the process of socialization is an ongoing one. Right now, this class is an agent of socialization. Your peers are an agent of socialization, your parents. But one of the things that we'll point out is that these different agents will take prominence in different points in our life. Like when we're young, from infants to about the time we start school, the family is the most, arguably the strongest agent of socialization. Mass media also influences people, maybe influences people throughout their life. We're going to examine that today. But, although, again, it's really significant when we're infants and children, right? It's very intense. That's kind of the point. We continue with some degree to be socialized or go through this process of socialization throughout life. It's not as intense though in the everyday. You can think about, we're going to give you an example of where one might undergo this process or be aware of this process of socialization in a very, acute way. And it's usually whenever it's very intense, it's whenever we're in a new situation and we're learning how to fit into that either space, group, or something like that. But we all get influenced. Our behavior is modified by others, and it occurs throughout, again, all the life, all the phases in our life course. To kind of give you a heads up again, we'll also talk about the construction of the self. You know, when we are aware of ourselves, we know who we are, we know our behavior is subject to norms or influence. You know, when we reflect on this idea of identity, like who you are, one of the things that we're going to propose is that, a lot of your identity, or if, from the sociological perspective, the majority of your identity is like socially influenced, like, how you, some categories, like how you identify as either male or female, your ethnicity, your race, even what you like, you know, we can explore as, you know, influenced by socialization. One of the key ideas here is this idea of social reproduction. So social reproduction is the process of perpetuating values, norms, and social practices through socialization, which leads to structural continuity over time. So for instance, when we think about masculinity or femininity, we look at the home, okay? For most people, they use this as a guide to understand what the expectations, and that's all we've been talking about since the first day, this idea of expectations. What expected behavior, what's the expected behavior of, you know, the individual in certain social situations? So when we think about, again, masculinity and femininity inside the home, there's gender role expectations, right, that people have. Now, they can be challenged, they can be negated, interrupted, but the point is that these ideas, you know, emerge over time. They are, you know, concrete in the sense that they matter to people, they influence behavior, and it's extremely subtle. We don't always realize that we're subject to this influence. Now, to kind of break up the rhythm of the class a little, I'm going to show a quick little video. Now, the video is a clip from the Mr. Bean series, and I kind of want to take it away from, you know, some of these more serious issues first to kind of illustrate how socialization works and what happens when people violate norms. And we're going to watch a scene where he's in a restaurant. Now, as you watch this, you know, you can ask yourself questions like, what does the character of Mr. Bean understand about dining in a fine restaurant? What are the mistakes he makes? How does he connect? You know, how does he, you know, there's certain points where you could see he's learning about what behavior is appropriate in that restaurant as he goes through this comedic act. But one of the reasons it's funny, one of the reasons people can relate to it is because it is rooted in something people can, you know, most people can identify in with, you know, being in a new situation, having these preconceived ideas of how to behave, and then having them challenged, and maybe even adapting on the fly to what the appropriate behavior is. You know, in this situation, you know, arguably it's, you know, how he, the expectations he's learning are very intense, and that's what makes it funny, I guess. So anyway, this is a quick short clip, about 2 or 3 minutes. We'll watch this and we'll be right back. Thank you.
have you decided, sir?
Yes. Can I have this, please?
The steak tartare.
Steak, yes.
You like a try to house wine, sir?
Yes, please. No. I'm driving.
In that quick little video, again, we, you know, one of the important things to understand from the perspective of this course, you know, it's, you know, he's breaching norms, things like that. We have to think about, like, one of the things you can think about is, like, how do people learn how to behave in restaurants? And again, this is the process of socialization. You're taught at a young age, you're taught by someone, or you watch others. And when people don't conform, you know, we have a reaction, like, you know, comedy plays on these ideas. If this were in a real setting, people would make, you know, gestures or expressions towards that person to try to understand or regulate their behavior. But anyway, let's keep moving forward. Let's talk about identity. Now, identity refers to the distinctive characteristics of a person's character that relate to who he or she is and what is meaningful. A group also has an identity. So groups can have identities as well. So some of the main sources of identity include gender, sexual orientation, nationality or ethnicity, and social class. Identity includes both the individual's social identity, or the characteristics that are attributed to individuals by others, and an individual's self-identity, or the ongoing process of self-development and definition of our own personal identities through which we formulate a unique sense of ourselves and our relationships to the world around us. Okay, so that's identity. So, you know, one of the things that we'll watch in a few seconds is, it's a little longer video, but we're gonna tie it into the family and some of these, this process of socialization. But before we get to that, when we think about identity, just to kind of clear this definition up a little, when we talk about social identity, these are the social categories. You know, if, you know, being labeled male or adopting this label of male, for example, or this identity or this category, however you want to kind of define it. There are social expectations associated with it. So certain behavior is expected, certain behavior is not. You know, how you, you know, kind of perceive yourself is also one of those things that is influenced by, you know, these ideas of masculinity, and for women, you know, these ideas of femininity. Now, whether you accept or reject them, that's another discussion. But what we're getting at is that when people form this, you know, identity of who they are, there are these categories that are generalized, but there's also these, you know, these ideas, these characteristics that we adopt ourselves, that we identify with, and we feel that it's what makes us unique. Now, when we think about identity, it's really a spectrum with social identity and self-identity, on two ends of it, right? And, we're always inside this, you're always managing it in a way that we're never too alike from other people, or we're never too different, right? Too much similarity is, unless the situation calls for it, seems like it's weird, right? You could think about when you and your friend might wear similar clothes or same shirt or same dress or same, what have you, right? It might seem funny or different or weird unless, the social situation, defines it as appropriate. Like if you're at work and you both work at the same place and you wear the same uniform, or you go to some kind of gathering where people wear the same clothes or apparel to show their affiliation to a group, like a sporting event. On the other side, when we think about self-identity, whenever we're too different, we run the risk of being shamed or being ostracized or losing our full social membership. So that's the other part. That's not to say that some people, that people don't exist, I guess, in the sense of identities, in, at the extreme fringes. But for most people, they'll be somewhere in the middle, always managing it. And the big point here is that these ideas, especially with social identity, influence how we think, how we see ourselves, and how we understand society from our own perspectives. Now, so through this process of socialization and interaction with others, individuals learn social roles. And that's going to be the key idea. Socially defined expectations for a person in a given social position, right? Social roles. One result of this process is the development of social identity, which we talked about. And, these social identities mark ways in which we are the same as others, okay, which is very important. Self-identity, again, sets us apart from as a distinct individual. So the concept of self-identity, which draws on symbolic interactionism, which we're going to introduce later today, some of the key ideas, refers to the process of self-development through which we formulate a unique sense of self and our relationship to the world. So to go back to this point against social positions, like a social position that you all have is one of student, okay? We talked about this before, right? You can think about the social roles associated with student, right? These are the socially defined expectations. You can even think about how we even rank students, right? As good or as bad. Like, what is a good student supposed to do? What is a bad student supposed to do? Or what are the expectations usually, right? Students are expected to meet these expectations, therefore they're good students. When they don't meet these expectations, then they get defined as bad students, it gets really complex. So sometimes you have students who are doing what's expected, and at the end of the day, what really labels one a good student or bad student is the grade that they get. On the other end, you might have students who kind of deviate from what the expectations are, and they might get good grades. So it's complex, but it's not only student. It has to do with your gender identity, sexual orientation, race, ethnicity, even class, right? Or some of these other kind of ideas that we adopt, and that's one of the good discussions that we can have about identity. We do things that may not conform to this general idea. You might be African American and, might listen to country, and that's okay, but why is it a little bit more unique? Because, what's the expectation as far as race? Like, what are you supposed to listen to? Or if you're from an upper class and you only eat fast food or something like that, or if you're, and we use these acts and these behavior, as cues to our identity, You know, you don't have to look too far beyond like social media. I think social media networks, I think one of the reasons that people post so many images of what they consume, you know, like for instance, what they buy, what they eat, where they go, what they wear, all these things is because, you know, they're maintaining an identity of who they are online. You know, like if you post something that is prestigious in the sense of class, like, oh, look at my new Rolex watch, right? You know, you have, and we'll talk about this in, you know, commodity fetishism or, you know, conspicuous consumption, things like that. But as we move forward, but when people post these things, you know, they're linking it to their identity, right? Anyway, throughout the life course, before we get to this video on parenting, throughout the life course, you know, there's different stages of socialization. The major ones are childhood, teenage years, young adulthood, mature adulthood, and old age. And each and every one of these stages have different expectations, right? In terms of how they're, not only how they're being socialized, but how they're supposed to behave, things of that nature. Like, you can think about you all as teenagers or young adults. What's expected of you? What's not expected of you, right? Are you having trouble like meeting some of the role expectations that you have, right? And these are, you know, very, can be very deep discussions or very deep thought exercises. And, you know, one of the things to kind of really keep in mind is that, you know, they're rooted in society. So, you know, it gives you a better understanding of like the parameters that you are working within or deviating from, if you're deviating. So anyway, these are the different stages: childhood, teenage years. I don't know if I misspoke right now. I said these are agents of socialization, but I do that sometimes. So I misspeak from time to time. So I hope I didn't, but I'm trying to remember. I kind of feel like I did, but just to make it clear: childhood, teenage years, young adulthood, mature adulthood, old age are stages, right? And even these stages inside the life cycle are even being challenged today. Like, you know, so there's a stage that some people identify now between childhood and teenage years, and that's tween, right? So anyway, we'll keep moving forward. So in terms of agents of socialization, these are groups or social contexts in which significant processes of socialization occur. Primary socialization from the functionalist perspective occurs during infancy and childhood, while secondary socialization occurs in childhood to maturity. Now, with primary socialization, it's so intense because during infancy to the early part of our childhood, we're learning a lot, you know. Even if you think about the expectations of children, the expectation is that they're not supposed to know everything, that they're always learning. As adults, you know, you can think about the situations that you find yourself in where you don't know what is expected of you or it's not clear, how awkward it might seem, or when you see others, like in our short video with the Mr. Bean character. If you were to observe this, right, your thoughts probably would be more chastising than it would be if it were a child, right? Children, you know, we kind of understand that they're going to make mistakes. You know, one idea I like to throw out there is that if you think about when children get gifts, right? And we'll talk about this as we go, but, you know, especially when we think about Piaget and Mead, you know, they don't understand all the rules associated with receiving gifts. So a child that's 5, you know, you give them a gift that they hate, they let you know they hate it. They may even cry in front of everyone. You know, people will take pictures, think it's cute, but, you know, if you as young adults cry and tell someone you hate their gift, you know, people will more than likely say, oh, you know, you're spoiled, or what's wrong with you, you know, socially stigmatize you, right? And if anything, we're taught, you know, to lie, right, about, you know, during the process of gift giving. You know, usually the modus operandi is to say you absolutely love every gift and how much you need it to show, you know, to give the person who is giving the gift a lot of, you know, to show appreciation, to reciprocate, the act of receiving the gift with you know, praise or other like, you know, emotions. So anyway, we have, you know, the family, school, peer relationships, peer groups, age grades, and mass media, right? These are all, you know, the major agents of socialization. So one of the things we're going to look at now is, you know, a video titled A Parent's Role in Cultivating Healthy Black Kids, right? So this is from a documentary, but the big point here is, you know, through these, you know, it's going to feature mothers, but through this discussion, you can kind of think about how they're very aware about identity, right? And how it's going to influence their children, how it influences their lives, and the role race can play in, you know, socializing the child, not only to be aware of who they are, but also to be aware of how society outside of themselves views them. So let's watch that now. It's a little bit long, 8 minutes, and we'll be right back.
We did it.
Nine years ago, I started working on a personal documentary called Little White Lie. The film follows my experience growing up in a white Jewish family, only to learn at the age of 18 that my biological father was black. It was a secret my mother had kept from me and everyone else. While making that film, two of my closest friends, Marette and Zahara, were crucial in helping me understand my new identity.
Is being biracial, half black, half white, a category of being black? Like, I think of it.
Definitely.
Yeah, I think of it that way. Being black feels good for me.
Because it's being true to yourself. I mean, it's being true to who you are.
Almost a decade later, I am married and have twin boys that just turned two.
Hi, baby.
I wondered what my friends could tell me about how to be the parents of black children in America today.
Hi.
How are you?
We brought stuff.
They brought lox and cream cheese and white fish salad.
Woo!
I'm just happy he actually smiled and won. Kai is like playing. I mean, he's being himself.
No, but he's smiling.
Right.
I know.
Lucas is really weird about photographs.
The three of us met at school and have been friends for more than 15 years. We now live in different cities and each have two young children, so we don't get to see each other often.
Cheers, cheers, ladies.
Yeah.
God. It's been way too long.
Way too long.
When you have kids, you have less time.
Two kids, two careers, that is hard.
Mm-hmm.
Without my mother, there's no way my life would work.
Which I think is just so interesting because if you think about our mother's generation fighting for us to have the right to work, and now we can't make our lives work without them. There's some irony to that.
Mm-hmm.
My mom was a single mom. I had a brother who was 10 years younger than me, so my mom was working. I was the one, you know, helping to prepare him for bedtime. Her being here for me now has really changed our relationship. It's just such a relief.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it is. Trust me.
Has your identity changed, like, racially in terms of looking at yourself since becoming a parent?
My racial identity?
Yeah. So for me, obviously going through my own journey of figuring out how I identify racially, and then being married to somebody who's black, I think a lot about how the way I look at my identity has changed from becoming a parent and having, you know, two little brown boys.
I think I'm a lot more conscious of the ethnicity since I married an Ethiopian man. I grew up in the States and I'm very American in my ways, right? And in some ways, my husband and my parents actually share a common identity, and I'm almost kind of like an outsider. And so what's changed for me is like really being super conscious about what language are we going to prioritize and how, and what does it mean to be raising a quote-unquote Ethiopian boy in America?
Right. I'm very aware of the fact that, like, I grew up in a white family in a white space. Race didn't really exist. There was like this lack of racial consciousness. I felt like I could be whoever I wanted to be, do whatever I wanted to do. Like, I never questioned that I would have access to things.
But yeah. I don't consider that a white thing. I think I grew up that way, too. This is the whole thing when you're, like, a first-generation immigrant, especially, like, coming from Africa, like, actually, you know, black people coming to this mm-hmm. country. The race thing can be really confusing from mm-hmm. that perspective. Because there, it's just, like,
everybody's black, yeah. right?
Yeah. But I also think in America, it's very hard to ignore mm-hmm. what's happening too.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Every day you turn on the TV, you can see something different happening to a man of color. Like the, I mean, it, or a woman, yeah, or woman, you know, or a woman, right? Yeah, a woman. Yeah. And do I still feel, well, as a person of color, impacted by that? Yes. But I can't say that that's changed the way that I would mm-hmm. raise my kids. Like, I want them to be responsible. I want them to be respectful. I want them to be able to be self-sufficient. Mm-hmm. I want them to believe that they can do yeah. anything that they want to do. I feel like it's almost too much of a burden to carry to think about myself or even my children in the context of what the world says their outcome will be. It's like, are we going to have the talk or not? Like, you are, or this is what society says you are, and because your skin is this color, you are limited in some ways. Therefore, you know, you can't run in the mall.
Yeah. When I think about how to raise my kids, obviously from my own experience of growing up with like so many secrets, I think a lot about this idea of just being really transparent. So it's mm-hmm. not, it's like, I think about it less about sitting them down the ceiling and having the talk, mm-hmm. right? I think about it more, like, how do you raise kids to be confident, but also like not to shield them from what is going on in the world.
Me and Z haven't had mm-hmm. that conversation. It's just too much to have mm-hmm. that conversation right now. And I think part of my husband's like, they're going back to Ethiopia for a certain amount of time because we're not dealing with this madness.
Almost maybe to shore yeah. up their own self-confidence.
Well, yeah. I do wonder, though, how do you control the messages being given to your kids? And
I don't think you can. That's where the dialogue hasn't really evolved yet. I think of things like the Jewish school. You learn about your culture, right. presumably, in those spaces. And I think about from the African-American experience, like, where do you ever learn, you know, your history before someone else teaches you that this is something to be ashamed of? How do I teach you first about all the beautiful things that come with it? I think even as a parent of color, it's like almost re-educating yourself. Mark's family is a great example of this. Like, when you go to his house and you look at their bookshelves, it's full of black history, of black art, of literature. They made it part of what they taught their children day to day. That's something I feel like is lacking. Like, you look here, there's none of that.
Yeah. It's about being conscious, I think, mm-hmm. of bringing that outside world in on mm-hmm. your terms in mm-hmm. ways that they can use and shape, mm-hmm. as opposed to the message mm-hmm. about the limitations or mm-hmm. how circumstances will define who you mm-hmm. are.
Antonio grew up going to a yeah. Black Baptist church, mm-hmm. and he is not religious anymore, but mm-hmm. he really felt like that was how he connected to Black culture. My Jewish identity is connected to my family, but I'm not really a part of any particular institution. What does it look like to be part of the Black community in our family? What does it mean to be part of the Jewish community in our family, or part of these different cultures? How do you pass that on if you're not part of a religious community?
It really is about, like, what are you exposing your kids to?
Right. Like, friendship circles. Like, I'm like, wow. Like, we all have kids. Like, we should actually, like, it yeah. should be a concerted yeah. effort that we actually get those kids I together.
Agree. Yeah.
Recently, someone was asking me who my mentors are. It's actually my friends. Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot of amazing true. Women I respect right. in my life
yeah.
who have really become the people I would want my kids to be around. Right. Yeah. It can't be just on you. Yeah, exactly. Right? I mean, I think yeah. that's the real point.
Right. So how do we all come together and yeah. actually commit to, like, bringing our kids yeah. together? Because so oh interesting God, because...
Do that. Yeah. Uh-oh.
Speaking of kids. Let me go check.
Yeah, go.
My friends help me realize that although I can't control the world my kids live in, I can love them, encourage them, and be real with them. And one thing I can control is the people I choose to raise my children around.
What are the takeaways?
Okay, the takeaways
we have to yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
So our kids. Hey,
that's
play
for real.
With each other.
We need to try this with family. Black families on vacation. Seriously.
So in that short little video, we definitely get to see the real questions that, you know, parents have you know, as they understand and reflect on, you know, what we are defining as the process of socialization, like, how do you expose your, you know, your children, you know, because they're very aware that, you know, of how their child will not only develop a sense of their own self-identity, but how their social identity will also be constructed by not only what they learn inside the family, but all these other agents of socialization. So that's the big key thing in that, you know, documentary, and how we're connecting it to sociology. You know, parents have some control, but they don't have, you know, absolute control over the world, right? You know, one of the questions, and again, we'll talk about this in detail when we get to gender socialization, but in terms of just socialization, you know, within all, you know, all these different agents, you know, exist in the world, it's very hard to isolate, you know, a child and keep them from, you know, either, you know, in terms of gender, you know, learning not or not learning, you know, gender behavior, right? You know, trying to teach them a gender neutral kind of perspective is extremely difficult because they, you know, get information from the media, from peers, from school subjects, things like that. I mean, when we look at the media that's made available, you know, that's why there's been a big push to get stories or from non-traditional families into, you know, elementary school, you know, libraries, you know, or inside classrooms, right? Because if you only have this, like, you know, one perspective, you know, it kind of alienates others and by de facto labels them as maybe even deviant, right? Anyway, very deep discussion there. Again, you know, if you rewatch this on YouTube or you seek out the full documentary, you know, ask yourself, you know, questions, you know, what part of culture are they, you know, again, were they trying to, you know, control or influence, or how are they were trying to, you know, socialize their children in a very positive way, you know, that, you know, within this, you know, dominant culture that, you know, doesn't always give the, you know, give people of color the, you know, the most positive kind of, you know, you know, labels and things of that nature. So anyhow, let's move forward. So let's talk about how sociology theoretically argues the self develops. And first we'll talk about George Herbert Mead and his ideas of the development of the self, the I, the me, and the generalized other. So according to George Herbert Mead, the child comes to understand being a separate agent by seeing how others behave towards him or her in a social context or in social context. At the later stage, entering into organized games and learning the rules of play, the child comes to understand the generalized other. According to me, the individual comes to understand the general values and moral rules of a given group or society during the socialization process. Now, just to take a step back away from Mead, one of the things that's influencing Mead is this concept of the Cooley's concept of the looking glass self. Basically, it goes something like this, right? We never see ourselves, we never experience ourselves in society. You can think about how you never really touch, hear, or see the authentic you. Like, you might see yourself on video or hear how your voice resonates in your head, but if you know, even if you listen to a recording, you might ask the first time, that doesn't sound like me, right? Reason for that is because, you know, your skull kind of resonates the voice, and your voice is so close to your ears, that's why it sounds different. But that's not really the point. The point is that we never really experience ourselves. We never really see ourselves. So how do we know we're conforming? Well, we depend on others outside of ourselves to reinforce or challenge, you know, our behavioral expectations, right? For instance, if you go to a new place, how do you know you're fitting in? Well, no one tells you anything, right? Or gives you positive reinforcement or a positive sanction, right? When you don't fit in, right, you might be negatively sanctioned, or you get these cues from other people, whether they're verbal or nonverbal, that your behavior is not appropriate, right? Or you would just watch others and you copy them, you mimic them, you conform to what they're doing in order to fit in, right? And you know, to a certain extent, we're building towards this idea that people want to fit in, people want to conform, it's safer to conform, we don't risk embarrassment when we conform, right? And you know, according to someone like Goffin, who we'll learn about later on, if not this week, next week, that's what we really risk, you know, risk embarrassment. So having said that, with the looking glass self, right, we depend on others, you know, we project this image of ourselves, we depend on others to reflect it back, and it's an ongoing process, and we're aware of ourselves, we're aware of others, and that's the key point, that our behavior is situated inside, you know, inside what groups or society or culture, situated inside these expectations, these shared expectations about how we're supposed to act, how we're supposed to behave, how we're even supposed to perceive ourselves. So with Mead, you know, he has two separate parts that he argues that, you know, happen when we develop. First is the play stage. The play stage is a stage where we mimic behavior, we copy behavior, we observe behavior, we see how others behave and learn what the expectations are, okay? Now, before we get to the game stage, right, the play stage is really defined by the familiarized other, right? The familiar other. So these are family members, friends, things like that. When we get to the generalized other, it's society for the most part, you know, or these social, you know, what's inside the collective conscious of the culture or the group, okay? Because, you know, one of the things that when we go into the theory, I should correct myself. Sometimes it's not important what society has to say, but it's important what the group has to say, okay? You know, that's when we get into subcultures and things like that. But having said that, you know, during play, children are practicing roles. You know, when children play house, you know, one child will be mommy or daddy. You know, think about how gendered those roles are and how they perform. It's going to be very much along what the expectations are according to their gender. Like if you have a boy, he'll probably adopt the role of daddy, right? If you have a girl, they'll probably adopt the role of mommy. And what they do might conform to the societal expectations, right? What they see on TV or what happens in their family. And, you know, sometimes they can, not behave as expected, right? For example, if they're copying, you know, the traditional breadwinner homemaker form, right? Most, you know, children might know that because it's, you know, well, maybe not anymore. I mean, media's changed a lot, but when I was young, we saw it in the media, this was the expectation, but you could also have a child where both parents work. And when, you know, if she's a little girl, you know, instead of staying home, she walks out the door, right? So, I mean, there's a lot of, that goes on there, but basically, you know, they learn according to the people around there. Now, the big thing with the play stage is that although children understand expectations, they don't understand the complexity of these expectations. They understand some rules, but not all of the rules, right? And that's going to really contrast it with the game stage. So, for instance, you know, one of the things we can point to is when children play sports at a very young age, like when they're 5, 4, right? They don't understand all the rules. So like if you ever have seen children play soccer, right, at that age, it's very chaotic. They only understand certain rules at a certain time, right? They might chase the ball. And you say, oh, kick the ball. They all try to kick a ball. They huddle around the ball. Or if they play t-ball, for instance, he says, hit the ball, right? You know, they swing, hit the ball, and they'll stand there. But that's because they don't understand all the rules. When they get older, see the same soccer game played with 14-year-olds, 13-year-olds. They're spread out. Their behavior or what they do or their expectations are according to, you know, are according to these roles that they're playing out. And this will kind of flesh out when we talk about the game stage, right? But before we leave the play stage, one thing I want to kind of show you all, and you can write this in, you know, we won't, it'll be helpful just to kind of, you know, if you have a response, I'll ask you questions right now, write it in, because there's only so much we can say about this video, and, you know, we don't want it to be a race or exclude anyone. So we're going to watch a video, and what we'll do is, I won't speak too much about it, but you can write in during the week or right after this or right now. And you let me know what this child understands and what they don't, and we'll talk about it next week. And I'll confirm some of your ideas or not. So we're going to watch a video showing a rapping two-year-old, okay? And keeping the game play stage and game stage in mind, right? Think about what this child understands as far as social expectations or the rules about, you know, rapping. There's parts this child understands and there's parts that they don't. So let's watch this. It's about 2-3 minutes. Very cute. I hope you enjoy it. But the lesson here is you want to think about what this child understands and what they don't about the social expectations regarding rapping. So let's watch this now, a rapping two-year-old, and then we'll be right back. Yes.
So here we come again, bring it back up. We're standing here, brothers and friends, right now. He's
go.
Going, go, 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 go.
Okay, welcome back. Hopefully you enjoyed that video, but just briefly, without going into too much detail, kind of think about what that child, again, understands about the social expectations surrounding rap, when we rap in groups, and what they don't understand. What they understand and what they don't understand. And you can see it in the behavior, right? There's certain things this child does that is probably copied from the adults around him, right? But there's things that, you know, he doesn't quite grasp yet. And that takes us to the game stage. As adults and when we get older, right, we're able to understand this concept of the generalized other, right? These social expectations. Like the reason Mead calls it the I and the me, right? The I is the unsocialized self, but the me is the objectified self. You know, we see ourselves as objects in the world that are supposed to adhere to social expectations. So this generalized other doesn't have a face like the familiar other. Like if your mother tells you don't steal, you might think, oh, I'm not going to steal because my mom would be mad, or my mom said not to. As adults, you might say, we're not going to steal because that's not what an honest person does. Now, this honest concept of the honest person doesn't really have a face, but it's a collection of values and expectations that we have in our society, right? And when we think about the generalized other, it's very complex. It's very abstract. There's a lot that goes into it. Like for instance, going back to when children play house, you know, a child might understand, okay, dad goes to work, he might walk outside, and then, okay, what happens at work? Well, I don't know. I don't, you know, haven't thought it, you know, about it that long. So they just stay outside till like maybe 2 minutes later, and they knock on the door and say, oh, I'm home from work, right? Or if a child plays the mommy role, right? The traditional mommy role, the housemaker, right? You know, they do these perform these very gendered acts, like take care of baby, clean the house, et cetera. But they don't look at the whole complexity of, or they don't really understand the whole complexity of what it means to be a father or a mother and the role expectations, how diverse they are, you know. So, I mean, it gets very deep. And as adults, or as we mature, we understand this more and more, right? So that'll take us to some of PJ's ideas about cognition. So really briefly, cognition is the human thought process involving perception, reasoning, and remembering. So according to PJ, the characteristic quality of a child during the early years of life is egocentric. Thinking involves understanding objects and events in the environment solely in terms of a child's own position. So as children get older, we know that we think about the positions of others. See, you know, this is one of the things about, you know, Mead and PJ, they kind of agree on these ideas. So sensory motor stage, you know, there's four stages that are pointed out. According to PJ, sensory motor stage is a stage of human cognitive development in which a child's awareness of the environment is dominated by perception and touch. Think about small children, right? They love to touch things with their mouth. They love to grab things, smell them, touch them. They love sound, things like that, right? It's all with the sensory motor skills, right? When we get to pre-operational, it's a stage of cognitive development in PJ's theory in which a child has advanced sufficiently to master basic models of logical thought. So you see the progression. You get a little bit older. You know, concrete operational, a stage of cognitive development as formulated by PJ, in which a child's thinking is based primarily on physical perception of the world. In this phase, the child is not yet capable of dealing with abstract concepts and hypothetical situations, right? And then we get to the formal operational stage. This usually happens in the preteen years or, you know, early teen years. According to PJ, and you know, as we read this, think about how, I guess, socially stressful preteen years can be, or teen years can be. One of the reasons for this is that children are able to think abstractly and even think about themselves being perceived by others and these different roles and obligations. So that's why they become much more self-aware. Maybe we even... adults accuse them of being, young people being self-absorbed or worrying too much about what others think. But there's a reason for that. You know, all this is new. When we get older, we, you know, understand more and are, you know, have developed tools and strategies to deal with, you know, peer pressure. Anyway, so according to PJ's theory, a stage of cognitive development at which this is formal operational. This is a stage of cognitive development at which a growing child is capable of handling abstract concepts and hypothetical situations. Like, for instance, hypothetical situation, like your parent might buy you a shirt that you don't really want to wear, but they force you to wear it. Hypothetical situation, or what will my friends think when they see me dressed, you know, like this? Or I have a pimple on my face. Oh my God, everybody's going to ridicule me. These are hypothetical situations. They take abstract thought, like shame associated with a flaw in the body, things like that. You know, these are very abstract ideas. Like, if you don't have the new whatever, or if you don't have sneakers that have social prestige, you know, this idea of placing social prestige or value on a pair of sneakers, and how it might lead to being ostracized, you know, and understanding all those kind of complexities as part of this formal operation. You know, people start to understand it here because of the abstract nature of those ideas. When you're very young, you know, shoes are shoes, right? There's not much to it. I mean, children will understand that there's some things that have some status or things of that nature, but not to the extent that, you know, might result in shaming and things like that. You know, they understand some of it, but not to the same extent or that, you know, preteens or adults do, right? But as adults, again, you know, we develop strategies and things of that nature to deal with that. So this brings us to gender socialization, right? We're going to focus on this for a little bit. I think what I'd like to first do is watch a video, but pay close attention because this is going to be related to our first written assignment. So let's watch this short video about this time last year, Target stopped labeling its toy aisles as either boys' toys or girls' toys, right? And when we get into gender socialization, you know, socialization in general is learning about social expectations. Now, when it comes to gender, you know, boy or girl, man or woman, if we kind of keep this binary, and we're only going to work with this binary for now, even the toys people buy, there's expectations. So, you know, if you go into, you know, the whole point with it, with this is like, maybe if we don't label them, it might be a little bit freeing. But let's watch this now, or I should say liberating instead of freeing. Anyway, but let's watch this now, and then we will be right back, and we'll kind of talk about gender socialization as a whole, and maybe even what the expectations are for the written assignment. So let's watch this, and we'll be right back.
Largest retailers is making some headlines this morning.
Target announcing a plan to eliminate gender-based signs from its toy, home, and entertainment department. Today, Chanel Jones is here with more on this story. Chanel, good morning.
Good morning, Willie. Target says it will stop separating items like toys and bedding into girls and boys sections in favor of the gender-neutral designation kids. It's a move Target credits to its evolving customers.
Dinosaurs and dollhouses, trains and tiaras, boy toys and girl toys. Separate color-coded aisles have been a staple in retail stores for years, a gender-based marketing trend that Target is saying goodbye to for good. The retail giant now removing gender references from a number of departments. Colors like blue and pink phased out of toy displays, and store signs will no longer feature suggestions for boys or girls in the bedding department, just options for kids. In a statement, the retailer says, "We know that shopping preferences and needs change. In some departments like toys, home, or entertainment, suggesting products by gender is unnecessary." The announcement comes 2 months after an Ohio woman tweeted out this photo of a sign in Target's toy section showing separate labels for building sets and girls' building sets. For many parents, Target's change is welcome news. One mom tweeting, "As a parent of a daughter who loves Transformers and Barbie, I applaud you." But other customers are skeptical. "So how am I going to be able to tell what is for boys or girls?" tweeted one user. "Why are we going to confuse kids at a young age?"
Toys are a form of self-expression, right? So if you can increase that repertoire, you're really saying you're okay. And as a result, our mental health will be far better.
So when do we pick up gender stereotypes? If this video posted by Bloomberg Business is any indication, at a very young age.
Now, tell me, what are your thoughts about that shirt?
No self-respecting boy in my class would wear that shirt.
Biologically, we're not hardwired to want pink or blue. So much of this is sort of social conditioning that happens as a result of generations and being passed on to us.
Target isn't the first company to get in on the trend. Later this month, Ellen DeGeneres is releasing a new Gap Kids clothing line for girls that encourages individuality. While Lego recently released a Research Institute line featuring female scientists. All part of a new movement to make sure that playtime is fun for everyone.
I think a lot of us can relate to this. The other day I was out with my daughter, she just turned 3. She had an Iron Man that belonged to her little brother, a toy truck, and she was wearing a tutu. I love it. You know what I mean? That, absolutely.
I always borrowed my brother's toys. I never gave them back, but I would just like take whatever they were playing
with. Borrowing,
I think once they go to school too, Natalie and I were just talking, then they kind of like, wait, princess, that's for the girls. Right.
Yesterday I wrapped my son in a princess Disney towel and he was like, ew, yuck, and he threw it in. Come on.
So there you go. So Target, kudos to Target. You know, I think they feel like the customers want, you know, they don't want the sections.
Yeah. Right.
Meanwhile, Dylan's brothers, thank you for pointing out that she stole their toys.
A little late for him, but yeah. Right.
Thank you, Chanel.
Welcome back. Okay, so there we see the short, you know, we just watched this short video about gender neutral shopping spaces, right? And our question for you all is for the written assignment is so you won't be writing emails to me. Please go to Blackboard to see the formatting and the expectations about the assignment. But you know, this will be a paper that you'll be writing. But the question in general, I want you to think about, why is it difficult for parents who might want to or would want to or who do attempt to raise their children in a gender neutral way to why is it difficult in general, right? And the key answer is that the family isn't the only agent of socialization. So for this assignment, this is what I want you to kind of really think about. The family is one agent of socialization, and we know it's one of the most powerful ones. And for the most part, in general, when we think about gender socialization, this is really where kids get socialized according to gender. Like, it doesn't matter really, like, well, I shouldn't say doesn't matter. It does matter. It helps, right? But at the end of the day, like, if a parent socializes their children around rigid, you know, gender expectations, like if they go to Target, right? And I'm not plugging Target or anything, you know. I'm not plugging Target. I don't think it's the best store or anything like that, but it's a good example. And I think it's in their interest to do this. You know, we're talking about it, we're plugging it, even though we don't want to. But anyway, getting off the point. But what I wanted to say, even though you don't put labels in the entertainment section, in the toy aisle, things like that, we still see it in action when parents go there. Okay. Now, this isn't part of the question, but the strongest agent of socialization is our parents. So, you know, a little boy might pick up a Barbie, but the parent might say, no, they're, you know, you can't have that. That's for girls. They're reproducing these gender expectations, or vice versa. Same family might have a daughter. Daughter wants a dinosaur. Say, oh, no, you got to get a doll. That's not for girls, right? And I mean, you know, when we think about agency and things like that, you know, and as we go through this, we'll really focus on it when we talk about gender. You know, it can, you know, limit, you know, it does limit, individual agency, but it can also lead to gender typing later on. So when we think about, again, gender, this is gender learning. It happens unconsciously as infants, and it's reinforced through children's toys, pictures, books, television programs, which tend to emphasize male and female attributes. Now, it's changing, you know, rapidly, but if a family, and this is, again, the question, if a family were trying to, you know, we did everything in their home to be gender neutral, it's all these other agents of socialization, like the media, school, peers, age group, grades, you know, I mean, peer groups, right? That will reinforce these ideas of gender because, you know, the family isn't inside a bubble. It exists inside society. So you can have a gender neutral family, but when that kid goes to school, right? Kids are going to reproduce their expectations about gender, like it or not, right? When they go into class, they might read a book, right, that reinforces certain gender expectations, right? Or the teacher themselves, whether they know it or not, whether they're aware of it or not, might be reinforcing gender expectations. They might say, this is for girls, this is not for boys, right? Or, you know, when we watch television, or if we watch television, you know, other sources of media, you know, this is for girls, this is for boys, right? I mean, it might not say for girls only all the time, but the expectation is that there's cues, right? Even when we see commercials or we go into these genderless or gender neutral toy aisles, right? You know, we might see only girls or, you know, on the packet of this toy or this product, right? So that's the big point with the question. It's really an exercise to talk about how gender socialization influences children outside of just the family. So that's kind of the key point. And if you want to get a good grade, just make sure you are concise, you get to the point. You don't have to tell me what Webster's dictionary definition is. I don't care about that. I want the definitions that are inside the text and what you think. You know, use your own examples. Cite sources, cite your text. I have guides that linked online. The best source will be your textbook, these lectures, and the slides that are available online. You can use sources outside the class, that's fair, but just a warning, sometimes they're not the best sources. They can be confusing sometimes. Like, for instance, you're often told not to use Wikipedia because it's not it's for sure it's not a peer-reviewed source in the traditional sense, but, from my position is that Wikipedia kind of gets a a bad rap, right? In the sense that, you know, for a long time people have criticized it for not being a very sound source. Like, for some things, it is pretty good for the most part. Even the American Sociological Association at one point encouraged sociologists to contribute to Wikipedia in the areas of their expertise. But having said that, if you look up gender socialization, you're not going to get a very approachable answer. You're going to get a lot of information, some of it that you might not need, some of it from perspectives that we don't really go into in this course. So that's the big warning, you know, just be, you know, inside the course, you know, the textbook is written for an audience that it, you know, you all as an audience, it understands that you don't really know everything about sociology. You don't, you know, you're just starting off your college experience. So it's not going to hit you with really, really deep theory. Like, I mean, with all these theories, we can spend the whole semester picking them apart, and we get into a lot of the theoretical realm, you know, with this. But just keep it simple. Cite your sources, have good examples. Your own original examples are always welcome. Like, you don't have to cite them. When I say cite them, like, I want you to define the term inside the work. Like, you should approach it as though you're teaching it to me. Don't just assume I know, okay? And, you know, also avoid things like saying things like back in the day, right? Give me, you know, maybe I do it sometimes in the broadcast without thinking about it, but when you write, you should avoid things like these general references. Be specific, right? And the assignment, you know, is double space. I don't need a cover page. You know, formatting can just be the general formatting, you know, that word processing programs have. You know, just keep it simple. Don't stress out about it, and you know, turn it in. Now, the last thing about turn it in is follow the directions. Like, if you're, and this is really a note for those of you who are using things outside of Microsoft Office. You know, Microsoft Office kind of dominates everything. But if you use Pages, Open Office, Google Docs, you have to export it as one of the file types that Turnitin accepts. I don't know if they updated, I don't think so, but like, for instance, if you write on a Mac, you use Pages and just save it as a Pages document and export it, I mean, try to save it like that, Turnitin can't read it. So what you have to do is, I think you go into the export or share, maybe not share, I'm trying to think of the Mac, but you turn it into a rich text form file or a Word doc file, like a dot doc. You know, it saves copy as. Now I remember. I use both, but I don't really use the Mac all the time. But you save copy as, and you should be able to get a copy that you can upload. But that's it for our discussion today. Next time we'll talk about nonverbal communication, and we'll explore social interaction. You know, do try the exam a lot of times. You know, it's going to take your best score. But that's it. Good luck, and so long. Bye-bye.